wasn't even enough left for one funeral, let alone two, and I certainly couldn't tell which was which. So we wrapped up the body that was in slightly better condition, said that was it to you, please, and buried him in your family's tomb. I have no idea if it was his body or Polynices, and I assure you, I don't care.
Why did you tell me this?
To save you. Do you think I can kill a child? I'm not a monster. Do you see, this is what you wanted to die for that pair of heartless crooks.
I don't know. I don't know anymore. I'm sorry, Antigone. Is no one pure? Is the whole world corrupt?
Yes, it is.
That's what I'm sorry for. Our world is rotten at the core. And so we must be a little rotten too to make any good of it. The best we can hope for is to be less corrupt than those around us. Those days, those storied days when men could be good, those days are long gone. If they existed at all.
No one. I have no one.
Listen, I can help you. We all bend the law for our own purposes. Just once I can bend it for you. I always loved you best. And Haman loves you.
Haman. My Haman.
Go now. Run away. Go with him. Go south, across the border to Athens. They'll welcome you there.
Haman.
Hold off the search until I know you're safe. There's lots of bureaucracy I can use to slow it down and still make it look like I'm trying to catch you. You can disappear down there. There'll be a trial here, you'll be burned in effigy, all that. But you'll be safe. Safe with your love, you can forget about all of this.
I'll go, I'll forget.
Good, yes, I'll call Haman. Forget. But don't think about the past, think about the future. The future you're going to give up.
The future. Sitting with Haman, growing up, growing old.
Yes, good.
Except,
what?
What would he think? Would he still love me if I did this?
Of course he
would. I want him to love me? Would I be worth his love, worth anything, if I sold out for something as cheap as happiness?
What do you say?
I'm asking. If I pay now, when can I ever say enough?
Never. Not until I'm bankrupt in my soul.
Antigone, be reasonable.
This is reasonable, isn't it? I should know the cost. So tell me, you with your spreadsheets and your bottom lines, what is the cost? What sins must I commit? What lies must I tell to this me, to Haman, to myself?
I only want you to live and be happy.
No! For your happiness is the opposite of life. Your happiness is death. Thank the gods I see it.
You nearly won. You nearly made me forget, but I will not. I will not stop shouting
stop
the truth.
Stop.
I will never
stop.
Stop.
They have
hurt me.
Stop.
They all hurt me. And that's why I'll never stop. The truth cannot be stopped. It is a way.
Stop it.
And it carries
stop
me.
It. Stop
it. Will not.
Take her away.
Stop.
Take her away.
And
shut her up.
It will not
take her
stopped.
Away.
Streets. Are you going to kill them all?
Some people are coming out. Yes, I'm sure some are. But most are with me. I promise you, son, more people want clean streets and full refrigerators than want some phantom of justice.
All right, take it to the people then. Ask them.
The people can't be trusted to know what's best for them.
And you say you're not a tyrant.
Listen, for 2 months now, there have been bombs and machine gun fire in my city. I love this city. I love Thebes, love her more than you ever thought you loved Antigone, I promise you. I've seen her torn,
apart. And finally, with the death of those two thugs, I thought we might heal again. But now that damn girl reopens all the wounds that were just starting to close.
She's doing what she thinks is right. You told me to do what I thought was right. That's how you raised me.
There's right and wrong, yes. But then there's what's practical. And sometimes, yes, sometimes that's even more important.
I don't believe that.
It doesn't matter what you believe. It doesn't matter what she believes. It matters what I believe. Why must I spend every hour explaining myself to children? I have a nation to run.
Of course.
I'm sorry. I want to listen to you. I do.
Does it have to be death?
Anything else and it'll appear I'm favoring her because she's my niece. It'll look like I'm bending the law for myself.
It's what the people want, too. Look out your window.
The law cannot be bent or the nation will collapse. As long as she stands against me, she must die or the state will fall.
But the people seem to think that a state that would murder a girl for burying her brother ought to fall.
No. Nothing is worth that. Nothing is worth the blood and the violence. There's a day, Haman, and maybe that day has come for you, when you have to let go of the tinfoil dreams you had as a child and take up the hard realities of being a man.
A man. A man. Is that what you want me to be, Mother? Does a man kill a teenager for disagreeing with him? Does a man ignore the shouts of the people because it might undermine his authority? What happened to you because you were like that once? I remember the arms that would pick me up and tell me everything was okay, that there was a meaning to this world, and that all the pain of growing up and all the terror of dark nights had a purpose. Was it me? Was I wrong? Were you always this scared, scrawny little thing with no real ideals beyond a balanced budget and enough police? Was I wrong?
Yes, you were. Sorry. What will you do, Creon?
Talking, calling out against my mother.
No! Don't you see? I don't care about They've kept me in this prison, but soon the sun will rise, and they'll take me to the tomb, and they'll seal the stone door, and the hunger will overtake me.
You mean Antigone is going to die for these ideals?
I don't care! I don't care about who's right and who's wrong and what the gods say or don't say! I want my sister!
If we can't save her, we can make sure her ideas live on.
I don't care about her ideas! I want her! Antigone! How can you be so heartless?
They took me there, to the tomb, to show me in a police van. They want to frighten me. I am frightened. I want nothing more than to bang on the door and call the guard and agree to their demands, but I can't. It will be all for nothing if I do.
Heartless?
Don't you see? All of the justice in the world isn't going to bring her back. And that's the most unjust thing of all.
He'll never know how much I loved him. I was going to spend my life with him. He didn't know it, but I was. I was ready.
They're going to take her at dawn. I heard the guards.
Where? Where are they going to do it?
Do it?
I don't think I can watch, but I have to be there.
Watch?
And they shoot her.
They're not going to shoot her. Didn't you hear?
What do you mean?
Creon was afraid it would encourage a revolt.
What are they going to do?
All the things that were going to happen. I was planning 2 days ago. College, then we'd get married.
It's me?
We'd go somewhere, far away from here, from our families, and we'd be happy. All the happiness I was going to have in the future, 2 days ago.
It's me. What are they going to do?
You can't stop
them. What are they going to do?
They're going to take her at dawn and seal her in a tomb on the cliffs outside of the city.
Alive? They're going to bury?
I thought you knew. I'm sorry.
No, that's horrible.
I heard from the guards. They're all over
the
palace.
We can't let them.
There's nothing we can do.
What do you mean?
Creon has all of the power.
Does she?
All of the men, all of the guns. That's what power means.
You just said you could have done more, should have done more, and now is the chance we do something, and you're saying no.
They'll shoot us.
So?
And it won't change anything. Just like Antigone, we'll go and we'll get killed, and they're still going to take her away. There will just be more people dead and no one safe.
Maybe. Or are they taking us?
Why?
Maybe I can't free her, but there's something I can do.
Cayman, don't be an idiot. Don't be like her.
Where are they taking her?
Tell me what you're planning.
She tried to stop me like you did her. How well did that work out, Miss Mimi?
Was it worth it? I wonder. Was it worth it?
You said you should have helped her. You said it might have made a difference, so help me.
It won't matter.
It might.
But probably not.
Those were the most cowardly words I've ever heard. Not that I can't change things. Not that I'll fail. Not that I'll make a difference. But probably not. What is wrong with you?
Was it worth it? I don't know. Probably not.
2 miles outside of Thebes. South of the highway, there's a cliff there. There's a cave. It was used as a tomb hundreds, maybe thousands of years ago. The door is made of stone. That's where they're taking her.
The sun is rising. That means it's time. They'll take me now.
It's time, then. It's time.
It's time. In a tragedy, there comes a time.
When the trap must be sprung.
There is no escaping it. That's what tragedy is.
In a tragedy, the horror takes place.
Offstage. Lest it be too horrible. And it falls to us.
The messengers.
The messengers.
The messengers.
The messengers. To bring back the news of catastrophe. Bricks to seal the tomb. They led her in at gunpoint. She staggered from the hunger. Then they began to seal the opening. There was a small group there, police, a news crew, no crowds. Creon was there. She looked pale, paler than usual. The woman spread thin. And then the screaming started.
From inside the tomb, but it wasn't Antigone's voice, it was Haman's. He must have snuck in at dawn to wait for his beloved. When she heard the screams and the sobs, Creon snapped. She ordered for the bricks. taken down and then started tearing at the wall herself with her bare hands.
Inside the tomb, Antigone swayed back and forth, hanging from the ceiling, with the cord cutting into the blue flesh of her neck.
And at her feet, crumpled and wailing like an animal, was Haman. He had been inside the tomb to die with his beloved, but she took her life first. That is when we saw Creon.
He dove at Creon, never looking more like an animal then, threw her back against the wall of the cave. The workers and police stood outside. They did not try to help Creon.
Creon was wearing her full dress uniform with the braid and the white gloves, and that nickel-plated service pistol was at her side, loaded and ready as it always was.
And in his rage, Haman grabbed the pistol, aimed it at his mother, who froze first and slumped, as if she accepted her fate.
But it was not so easy, not for her. No, Haman turned the gun around, his eyes never leaving his mother's. And he shot his brains out in front of her.
A tragedy must end in catastrophe.
That is the purpose of the machine.
But catastrophe is not death.
Death is too easy, too common.
Death comes to all of us.
Pray that catastrophe arrives.
Catastrophe is the worst thing.
The thing that must not happen.
The realization that everything you wanted is ruined.
Everything pure is corrupted.
Everything safe is destroyed.
And it's all your own fault.
How merciful would it have been
for Haman to kill Creon.
But that would have denied her
the catastrophe she had earned.
And the revolt.
That was sure to follow.
The news spread fast. By dawn, the streets were full
of protesters and flags.
Within 2 days,
Creon found herself praying
to Zeus, Athena, Dionysus.
It was too late.
But it was not
the will of the gods alone
that caused this catastrophe.
It never is.
Their instrument was
a 16-year-old girl.
Not a special girl.
Her sister was smarter.
Her boyfriend was kinder.
But a girl who knew
the truth is like gold.
And must be treasured.
And protected.
And fought for.
And if it is, it will last.
Truth will last eternally.
It will not rust nor tarnish.
It will gleam for 2,000 years.
And then 2,000 more. Tomorrow. And the day after. And the day after.
Next week.
I would love for Serenity for you to talk about the process a little bit, talk about what happened over the last 3 weeks.
Sure.
Would you guys mind?
Yeah. So for STC Sr., what we do is, so for 3 weeks, we have classes in the mornings until about noon, and then we eat lunch, and then we come back and rehearse the play for the rest of the afternoon until 4 o'clock. So every day, so for the first week, we had like get-to-know-you games, and we like worked on ensemble building in the mornings, and we did a lot of table work in the afternoons. So we went through the characters and a lot of the line work, looking at what different things the characters were saying, what's important to them. During the second week, we had a whole lot of guest artists come in the morning. So we had a bunch of artists from different universities come in, and they taught like short classes about different things. Like we had ensemble building, and what else do we have?
Meisner.
We had the tourist board.
Oh, yeah.
And then we blocked all of the show during that week. And then this past week, we had, during the morning, we mostly played games. and did a lot of ensemble building again and got to know each other really well, and finished up rehearsing and running through our show so that we would be prepared to show you all tonight.
Yes?
Do you have anything to add? Ralph is
what
Ralph
is.
Did you use any other examples of Greek, classical Greek, adapted to a modern setting? Was that hard to find examples of that?
We didn't use, I don't know if like Ian might have like looked at others, because there definitely are. Like I'm familiar with a play called Iphigenia 2.0, which is like a modern retelling of the play Iphigenia at Aulis. But Ian, did you look at stuff like that?
So in doing this, so Jerry came to me almost a year ago and said, hey, wanna to update Antigone? And my first thought was, but there's a perfect adaptation already, because Jean Ennui in 1945 did this amazing, genius, brilliant adaptation of Antigone when he was living in Paris when it was being occupied by the Germans, right? And the Germans said, you can't write anything critical of the Germans. So he wrote this adaptation of Antigone and said, I'm not criticizing the Germans. It's a 2,000-year-old play. And it clearly was criticizing the Germans. And it's a work of genius, and it's perfect. but one of the things that is very clear in the actual Sophocles text that Ennui didn't hit in his was this sort of generational divide between Creon being the old man and Antigone being young, right? And that's in Sophocles, and it's something that Ennui completely ignores in his otherwise peerless version of Antigone. So when I was writing this one, I was looking both at the Galantier translation of Ennui's and the Richmond translation of Sophocles, and taking elements from both of those, as well as I teach high school, so like cell phones are sort of like the bane of my existence. So those were like the three sources that I looked at when putting these together. But the thing is, the Greek plays there are. In Iphigenia 2.0, there's a number of Greek plays that have been updated for modern audiences because they are so durable, right? You know, they last forever and ever and always. I have a quick question, because I was here for the talk back last night, but I just wanted to ask, now that you've done it twice, what have been the difficulties or challenges or interesting things about doing it with a double cast like this? Yeah.
I really enjoyed it because my other is me, Cassidy. We, like, the first week, whenever we were, like, just getting to know each other and we were, like, first going through the script and, like, deconstructing it, I guess, we all, like, got together with our character partner and had, like, a really long, long discussion about every scene that we had and, like, our opinions and thoughts and whatever. And so I thought it was really interesting to talk to Cassidy and hear about her thoughts on the play and mine and our thoughts on our character. And then to hear Susanna and Jamie and Gloria and Sammy and the Haymans.
Oh, you poor male.
I swear I know their names. But yeah, it was interesting. I enjoyed it, yeah.
I found that, you know, me and Sammy, we kind of had different takes on the same character, like both equally valid and both good, but different. And it was kind of interesting because it would be something new every time I watched her cast do it.
Me and Jamie have such like a big age gap. It was interesting because she's like an adult.
Yeah.
And
oh, yeah.
Not, and it was weird.
Yeah, I think it was, I actually got not like jealous, but when I saw Susanna do it, because Antigone's 16 in the show, and I'm 18, and the cast that performed last night, the A cast, is older in general. Like, I'm 18, and Cassie and Sammy are 18, and then Colin's like 14. But like the cast, yeah. But the cast is just like older, surrounding it, I guess. And I watched Susanna do the show, and she just had this air of, like, I guess, like, teenage energy in her. Like, and that sounds really weird, but, like, she was, like, instead of getting, like, super in her head with, like, these are the moral things and these are, like, what Antigone is contemplating, which is more of the way that I looked at it. It was a lot of like Antigone's like mental health and her philosophies in life and stuff like that. But like when Susanna would do it, she would just do it. And when she was fighting with Creon, it was legitimately like, I'm not thinking about things, and the lines didn't seem like this is a higher philosophical power. It was just like, these are things that I believe, and they kept coming. Like, it was like, I'm a teenager, and I have things to say, and it's been blowing up, and I have so much energy, and I was like, I can't get to that, because I'm not her age, and I'm not a 16-year-old, and so I kind of just had to accept the fact that our Antigones were going to be different, and I think at that point, it was really awesome, because I got to watch, like, her do her thing, and me do my thing, and, like, it was really cool.
I was, like, just natural immaturity.
As someone who screams at you, I agree.
We like getting questions.
So. Yes, we do.
This is fun.
This
is going to be awkward. You guys don't ask us stuff.
I mean, they'll just talk if you don't ask.
Yeah, well, we're really good at that.
I will ask. Did Creon's argument resonate to either of the Antigones at any point or to any of the other cast members?
Oh, yeah, because I'm right.
I started the hashtag Creon did nothing wrong. I'm in the Creon camp.
Creon
isn't like an angel. Can't come from the heavens, but she's doing something important for her country, and she's taking charge even though it's really hard for her and everyone around her. So yeah, Antigone's kind of, but yeah.
Susanna explained it really well when we were doing a bunch of like character study work, which our director made us do. And at first we were like, okay, we're talking to our other person for an hour. But it was really like helpful and inspiring. But Susanna described it as like tunnel vision, where Antigone has like this tunnel and all the other characters are outside of it. And like, that's a lot of what I saw as like depression, is not really seeing what other people and how it affects other people. But we actually read through the script, and the first time we did it, Susanna and I were like, we don't agree with anything, Antigone. Like, there are some things where it was like, we were talking about like posting pictures on Twitter, and I was like, I'm pretty sure a dead body on Twitter is like against the terms of agreement. Like, I don't know one that would stay up, or like, yeah, but it was stuff like that where we were like, okay, we're playing this character, and eventually we got to the point where we were like, we appreciated it and whatever else, but I think everyone started with like, we're team Creon, and then by the end of it, like 3 weeks of sitting on it, we were like, there's not really like a right and wrong here. Like,
I mean, I was talking to Ian about it last night, and he said something that I found really interesting, that so Creon has all the reasons for being right. Like she has, well, you're immature, you don't know what you're doing, I have a nation to run, blah, 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 blah. Literally continues on for 11 pages. Then, no criticism. And, but Antigone only has, I'm right, and you're wrong. And that's all she goes, and she just keeps saying that, and eventually, you know, she is right.
I felt so bad for Creon, because, like, even in, like, Oedipus Rex, which is the story before it, like, she doesn't want the throne ever. Like, she's like, if someone else can get rid of this Sphinx, like, it's all yours. Marry my sister, whatever, I don't want it. And then, like, you know, and then she has this plan for the brothers to take over, and then they kill each other, and she's like, great, now I have to do it again. And she just kind of wants to, yeah, she just does it because she has to. And it's just, if she wants it to be trapped, it's sad.
There was a question over there. I think you...
Oh, me?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. So for the cores, because you guys were the same cores last night and tonight, so how was it for you all?
It was really interesting to see both of their takes on the characters, because after we would do character studies individually and with their partners, and we would like go over blocking and lines and stuff, we would all come back together and talk about it, and it was really interesting, especially since we were like one person and they're two people, so like we can read it one way and then both of them can read it a different way, so it's kind of like so many different takes on the same character. And then also just some of the blocking was different. But that's just something that we practiced all the time.
Did the chorus did you think of it as four separate characters? And if so, what were the differences between the four characters?
This is